Hello, everybody, and welcome to this panel. I also personally want to thank Inbao, whoever she is out there, for inviting me and us to this panel, which I think is very important, obviously. And I think it's great that we have this variety of topics on this gathering. I'm really, really glad to be part of it. So how this panel is going to be is that each of us has different approaches on sustainability on film sets. And we each going to present ours for like 10 to 15 minutes per person. And then we will open the discussion for you, because obviously sustainability is nothing that only we can discuss, but we all need to take care of and discuss, especially for the generation to come. So we highly encourage you to ask us questions and also what you have been doing on sets to be more sustainable. First of all, I just want to, I mean, it's in the program, but just to tell you who's here. It's Blair, Barnette from the UK. We have Tomety from Ghana, and we have William Abello from France. And I'm Merlin. I'm the guy who asks all the questions, so now I'm on the panel. I will actually start with my own approach, because I will make it quite brief to give the other panelists time. So if we can switch to the thing. So my journey into sustainability began not so long ago, it's like 7 years ago, when I was watching the documentary How to Change the World on the foundation and founders of Greenpeace. And I was thinking, okay, what can I do to actually change the world and change the world in my direct surrounding, which is and was the film industry? So I always kind of had a hate-love relationship with plastics. Like, I mean, plastics is an amazing material. You can mold everything and will last for centuries. On the other hand, plastics is one of the top polluters in the world, destroying nature, and has like the most carbon in this current climate crisis. I mean, but I don't want to go deep dive into that, because that's not what this panel is about, and I'm very passionate about that. But what we did, we founded Plastic Free World, and we did a very simple thing like 6 years ago. We tried to convince all the caterers in Germany to switch to reusable cups, not to use plastic bottles anymore, but water suspenders, or just tap water, actually. We were quite successful in that. Our cups were made out of rice husk, which is waste material from the rice industry, which made it lightweight for caterers. It was really important for them not to have like heavy things on their trucks. We were quite, again, successful. Like all of the caterers in Germany were using it, actually. Then, of course, we had a pandemic coming up, and all that was going backwards, and then we had to use single-use plastics again. But now we are slowly going there again. We progressed Plastic Free World to be an online marketplace, actually. Last year we had over 4,000 products online, completely plastic-free, from over 300 vendors. I just wanted to show you that real quick, that you can actually progress from the film sets to the whole world. That's what I had in mind. Eventually, we actually had to close down this marketplace this year, because it was not profitable, and like marketplaces like Amazon would just crush us. But what we also did, we did our own productions called PFW Productions, where we did like small commercial and infomercial films. We wrote them ourselves, we filmed them and edited them, and we actually gave them for free to the companies who would, in this case, it was Soul Bottles, it's like they do glass bottles, and we gave them for free so they could use them as commercial material. And currently we are working on a short film called The Plastic World, which is a bit of a serial world of where everything is just made out of plastics. Anyway, what I came up with last year, I invented a sustainable Christmas tree. You would say, why the fuck a Christmas tree? But I actually don't know why it is a Christmas tree. But what we did is I wanted to do something about all the backdrops I was building and then just throwing away. So what we did is we take the backdrops, we cut them over CNC into this modular tree system, and you can take it apart and put in a box like the size of the table, and you can reuse it like for 20 years. And we were selling that to Deutsche Bank and like more corporate world. What I wanted to try to say is you can always expand your vision over the film sets and think about how can I actually use the materials and stuff I'm using on a film set on a broader scale. That's what Tony will also talk about in a minute. So if you need a Christmas tree, we are still taking orders, not so many, but you can, yeah. Anyway, so I will hand over to Tony, who will talk much more about, yeah, you need to push this button, about recycling of materials and stuff. Yes, thank you.
Okay, I guess coming from where I'm from, I mean, it's pretty different from everyone, you know, the way we do things. But probably the journey for me would be when I decided to set up a prop house. And this was the first prop house in my country. I mean, 50 years on since we established the film industry, this was going to be the first one. And the idea was to collect all these things that we use on film sets, on all the shows that I did, like store them up, be able to reuse them, get a budding film industry to kind of like come back into those spaces and reuse those things. So that way we kept collecting a lot of things. When I began, I think we started with, I finished like two shows, was like Beast of No Nation, which I did with Imbal. And then I did, which one was it? Black Earth Rising. And then from then on, I said, look, I needed to start collecting these things. And then we needed to start, you know, packaging all these things where people can come back and use them. So if you, right now, I mean, we are sat on like a 750 square feet space where I have close to like 4,500 items like I've collected from shows that I've worked on, some by the street that I find. We have a little sound stage on the side, so people are able to come in, and then a construction site as well. When you go into like Prop Haven, for example, you would see stuff like that. That's a bunch of different things which we collect from all the shows that I probably worked on and been on. And it's just everything you can find, from furniture to like drinking glasses to anything that has ever been on shows that people have ever used. I mean, because we started this, and because it was the first one, what happened was we started getting people who are working on shows or who work on shows and literally call you and say, look, we have stuff, do you want it? You know, because then people didn't know how to dispose of the items, and then we'll go pick them up and, you know, store them up, clean them up, refurbish what we want to refurbish, and yeah, store it so anyone else can use it. Literally, we just call it anything at all. And this is the first prop house in Ghana. I mean, initially, this was actually my thesis topic as well, and it took me 12 years to do it. But, you know, I'm glad that we have something like this where people can recycle the stuff that they use on sets and then bring it out to us. If you like there's different type of things in prop heaven that people use. Like you can see, there's just so many photos I couldn't put everything up. But like the idea that we started from 300 items and now we have about 4,500 items where people can use and bring back to us, and like, you know, and then it helps them. It's cheaper. From where I come from, of course, the budget is an issue. You know, we talk about all these SDG goals, like, you know, sustainability, but then I think about the poverty part of it as well. You know, if you're doing these things, you're doing these things to help the people. You know, so that's how I think about it. And so that's why we established Prop Heaven. It's interesting to kind of like see where I did this project, for example, with Michaela, far right. Right, and you see that book which she holds on that shot, and it's actually from a show that I again worked on with her, which was and that was 3 years after. Like she was now back in my studio because now I had built a studio, and then they were in my studio. Vanity Fair was in my studio, and we had to do that thing for the Hollywood Fantasy 10 in the 10 act, and that little book that she has there was something we still used to dress a set. So it was like, oh, we're back to the same thing. But then, well, I kept it, and I stored it, and then now she gets to use it again. And we, you know, things like that. Like that little red couch was something that I wanted to keep in the store. For me, I call it like from Accra to like the streets of London, because that's a Piccadilly show. You see the red couch where this guy sat in, and it's from Prop Heaven, but then that's Whiskey, and then you can see it back on the screen over there, and that's how far you can keep all these things, and we keep using them. A lot of people come into our space anyway, and you know, because these things are there, it's easy for them. We keep storing the things, I mean, and they keep using them, and they keep creating all these things, because that way it's also easy for them. When I've built sets for different things, sometimes I like to be very constructivist. So like, I would go into the neighborhood, or I'll think about what is in quote garbage or what people don't need, and be able to use these things and turn them around. And after I probably also use them, like, you know, I can give them back to the community. So I had a job where I had to like build this big monument, and I thought, look, why don't you build this with like broken pieces of glasses? You know, like just get bottles and just break them up. You know, build all your scenic flats and put a fabric on them, which I like to use a lot of fabric instead of a lot of wood. So like I'm pretty much doing like 20% of wood and then 80% of fabric for everything I do. And then on that particular one, we did, sorry. That's what we're doing. Like we built all these scenic flats and we took all the bottles from the garbage, cleaned them up, broke them into little pieces. I was just trying to do like a little refraction from the lights when I set these things up, and we did all that, and I mean it turned out to be something great. That if you look on the bottom of the screen, the actual image on your right is what we're trying to create, like for what we were looking for. And what we did with the broken bottles is what is on the middle screen. But if you look further down on the left, I did that same thing a year after, and I used like corrugated roofing sheets. Like things like that is what I use. Like, I mean, these things exist, they're around us. People don't know what to do with them, but then I turn them around and like, you know, use them as texture and use them as background, and then I do things like that with it. And again, after using them, I can always give it out to people who actually need roofing. Because like I said, where I come from, there's still the poverty side of the things, you know? We need to help the community. So like, I like to use things where I can give back to the people. Yeah, and because I like to do a lot of like, I do a lot of canvas work, like print backdrops. But again, like I said, I just do that really with like less wood. So I don't do a lot of like plywood stuff, like it's just frames. I build all these things in modular sizes. So I can always go back and pull the sizes and I can put them together like a Lego. And I use them all the time and I can always keep changing these things. I'll show you. For example, these two little sets, they're sets, but everything here is fabric. I built everything from fabric, like 20% wood for framework, but literally built everything from scratch from fabric. And of course, if I don't tell you, you probably don't know, but that's what I'm doing. And I think because I started this back home, a lot of people are copying. I mean, unintentionally, but they're doing it. But you know, it becomes a drive. It becomes like a movement where people think, oh, these are other ways of doing these things. Like, can we also try it? So I pretty much like trying my hands on things like that, where again, then it becomes also less expensive. You know, you don't spend too much money. Like, you know, but then you get a look and feel, and people are able to do whatever they want to do in it. Example of another would be, this is all canvas printed anyway. I'm not sure I get to have Roscoe to give me like soft back, but you know, I find my ways of doing all these textures. And sometimes I probably tell you a little trick when, I mean, the little video when he talked about the reflections and stuff like that. Like when I have these canvas prints, I want to get away from the reflections, I literally will tell the printer to print from the back, because in the back is more matte. Like you can actually get, you know, use the material and print from the back instead of the front. And I build all these things in framework, and I just put the texture on it. I can reuse some of the textures again. You know, if I don't want to use it, I have different ways of like giving it out to the community where I come from. But this is what I've been doing. We usually could give like some of these canvases and all the wood that I use when I don't need it. Like I literally will put it out there. The local carpenters in the community will come for them. They make like little seats and chairs for their people. Like people use these things for like little stalls, like, you know, where we sell. Because if you ever came to Ghana, you see that. I mean, you should come, actually. Put it on your bucket list, people. Please come to Ghana. And you would see stuff like that. That's like a canvas print backdrop. And when you don't want it anymore, you send it back to this industry, people who actually, the craftsmen who are there, they're able to turn these things out and make like canopy tops. You know, like all these little wood that we don't need anymore. People make little stalls like that. They sell from it, artifact, food, anything at all, like literally. I live in a space where things are pretty organic. We have a lot of fiber, so we have a lot of artifacts. I mean, artisans who can turn things around. So it's the thing of finding the people and, you know, saying to them, look, I have these things, you can come for them. And again, then it makes life easy for them where they don't have to go and you know, pay for things and buy new things. I'm probably going to end here. Like, you see those little stools like that people make, like that's what when people have them in their homes, like, you know, it's pretty, nothing is just cut a top and put your legs together and then you can sit on it. It's not like, you know, they're functional items at home, and then people are able to use all these things that we give them back to them. Those little pieces of broken glass that you saw when I used for that set, actually, that's what it on the right side, top right, because it's been crushed a lot more. And that's how we make beads from where I come from. All these beads that people wear, like, you know, like all these colorful beads, make all these beads from bags, like necklaces and earrings or whatever. We use all those broken bottles for it. So for me, even though I used it for that, I was able to, like, you know, repurpose that same thing. I gave it back to a friend that I knew was into that industry, and then they were able to make all these things for me. So, I mean, I'll probably end here and then I'll probably say, yeah.
Hi, that's me. I'm Blair Barnette, and I'm speaking about sustainability from the perspective of, I'm the chair of the British Film Designers Guild. And as an organization, I'm trying to bring awareness to this and to try to make some change. Like, we're all trying to make change. And as an individual, we can all do small things, but I really think, I mean, you know, it's not even me thinking. It needs to come from the top down. It needs to come from a broader perspective. And, wrong way. I'm not very technologically inclined. here's a hard, cold fact. A single big budget film produces about 3,500 tons of carbon. We could compare that to running 800 cars for a whole year or flying a full-capacity Airbus plane around the world 15 times. That's what we do when we make one film. And how do we change that? There are small things. I mean, we obviously are providing a lot of waste, and we're providing wasting a lot of energy to be able to do what we need to do. But how can we offset that? And the problem, from what I see, is we have a lack of transparency in education amongst all of us. Most film productions aren't very clear about how they're going to be sustainable. There's a lack of department cohesion. What makes things sustainable being nearly impossible. And there's currently not a universal terminology amongst all of us. Like, we sometimes even have to explain to productions why we need 2 weeks to wrap a location. You know, that seems to be something that we're always talking about, and now we have to add a sustainability factor to that. It needs to be something that we understand and is universally understood when we go into filmmaking, just like how many trucks do we need, how much time in prep do we need. That just needs to be a constant and a given. And we've got a lot of companies that are greenwashing. They'll claim to be sustainable, but then they'll outsource certain aspects of the production to other smaller companies. Amazon is a really great example of this. They have a really great standard, but then they get smaller production companies or service companies to run the show that don't follow on from those same guidelines, and it kind of gets lost in translation as it gets handed down to smaller factors. And some companies will simply say they're being green, but provide no evidence of that. And because we're so insulated and we don't necessarily talk about what we do to the press, we're so like guarded about it all, there's no accountability for that. And then we have power dynamics. And while there's a vast seam of theoretical thinking being published about the environment, and practices in the media, very little tangible improvement has been made. I can't even read what I've said here. It needs to come from the top. You know, it really needs to come from the top down, because it's all kind of academic until there's actually big power structures doing the work. And here we go. The other way?
Other way.
Down. Right. In order to create a sustainable film sets, we need to make it a community effort. Creating department cohesion, coming up with a universal terminology, and challenging the current power structures are the first steps that we need to make in order to see real change. And now I'm going to just talk to you a little about my experience, how it's been. This has been something that's been important to me since my early days at Nickelodeon, where we would have a prop store that was there on set, and we'd run out of one can of spray glue and send a driver an hour across town to pick up the spray glue and come back. And that used to absolutely drive me bonkers. So I started keeping things in a little storage space off set. So that people could ask me, I know Blair will have it, and so they can come get to me even at midnight. They can get a can of spray glue instead of sending a driver. And we would have massive things shipped in cardboard, which we'd throw away, and then we'd need to make models out of cardboard, so we'd buy cardboard. And I thought that was ridiculous. So I started kind of hoarding all these materials. I mean, you can appreciate this, right? We're hoarding materials. I was a massive hoarder. Then I became this love for actually making things out of stuff that was just around set, around the studios. Am I going backwards again? Right. I didn't know this was going to start. That was a bit weird. Okay, that is... These are three little commercials that I've made for Facebook using cardboard and one of our sponsors, Pulp Art Services, made the materials. They're all made out of cardboard, and we sent all the trucks were electric trucks. We tried to use as many recycled materials as possible, and this is from a massive company, Facebook. We got another one. Wait, that's the same one again. This is going very well. always down. Okay, here's another one, and you can see the brick pattern. That's actually made out of paper, and those walls that flew away, that was all recycled cardboard. And then there's one more, and that is printed. Actually, how does it play? We're winning. And obviously these are really small. This isn't a model that you can have on big film sets, but there is an idea in there. This is back in Nickelodeon days. On the right, that's a set that I did for one of their big popular shows in the 90s. And I actually walked around the studio and found bits of metal that you could see at the top. You know, we wanted something conceptual that was a little industrial, a little bit weird, but instead of buying brand new things, I just found what was around the studio and put it in. And I mean, this was a popular show that ran for years and years and years and years and years, and like I was allowed to do that, and they liked the idea of it. And then on the top, this was from The Big Help. This is those, what you see there, if you could see the guy kind of in the right-hand corner, in the bottom, that's a person, but you could see the size of everything else. Those were all stretched canvases and cardboard structures that we took to the White House to be able to pitch this idea. And they were all used from the ends of rolls. Like, we didn't waste new canvas, we used the end of something or repurposed a backdrop and repainted it. And this was an initiative to go into parks around the country to be able to redo, you know, green spaces that weren't really being used, or parking lots making into a park. It was, you know, it was an initiative to try to make more green spaces and the beginning of being eco in the business. And this is something I did during lockdown because I had a lot of time on my hands, as we all did. And this was an animation that was made completely out of recycled Amazon packaging that I had stored in my place. There's a lot of that going on. It was called Scrappy Cats, and it was all about different cats around the world that were made from recycling and how they can interconnect with each other. It's actually a show I'm pitching and trying to get sold right now, because kids around the world can use their own recycling at home and make these puppets with their parents, make these shows and share with each other and show that we're kind of all in the same place. And that's something else that's important to me in this business, is bringing the idea of something that's handmade, that's not computer generated, that's not technological, that doesn't use a lot of resources, something that you can make with your own self, with your own hands. This is the same, also more packaging from Amazon. I did a commercial for Lego that is made all from those packagings. And here is the commercial. What's that? So it is toys, but you know, it's, I mean, how much fun, when I was a kid, there was like Lincoln Logs, do you know? I didn't have video games, and we had to make the environments ourselves. And that handmade quality doesn't use a whole lot of energy, and it's, I mean, it's bringing kids back into being kids. And this is on the same philosophy. A lot of the larger companies, like Disney, like Lego, they're asking me to make these smaller sets. that are made entirely out of recycled materials, because it does kind of bring that childlike quality back into it. And if these large companies have this vision, surely we can translate this into actual filmmaking. And this was entirely made out of also recycled sets. I made proper like old school backlights, matte paintings in the back. Collected loads of things in the house, and just we had like a bueno time making it all. And now, what is that? Oh yes, exactly. If you look in the bottom right-hand one in the back, that's in the top. That is a recycled water bottle from the production that I was on that we just painted, and you know, it looks cool. And then I'm going to play you now just a little behind the scenes to wrap this up of the making of this, which I thought was a lot of fun. Oh, wait, that's it actually moving. You can see down. Come on. Here we go. The only thing we paid for was a little bit of glue. Thank you.
Oh, William Abello. Okay, so sorry. So, well, you know, in my aspect, how I see all that we have to do is the future. And more to say in the present nowadays is, as you have said, we need to be a collective and we need to be, you know, if you are alone in your set, even if you are the top and the head department, you need all the others. So in France, we have the chance to have two association, let's say 200 people of the art department, and HADESE, which is only producers, designers, you know, and MAD with all the others, all right? So we do it like that. We stay all together and the other of the department. So in fact, we mixed always. And little by little, pardon. And so everything started in 2009. You know that in Paris, maybe in this time, 80% of movies was shooting in this era, just around Paris. We call that the Paris Island. And nowadays, it's not so true. It's maybe 50-50, you know, it's better for the others. But it was an incredible laboratory because we have, let's say, 200 features movie and 200 TV movies. So we can make, real, we can improve that we want to found. That means a real concrete tools and to have new skills about how to do it better, all right? So, and in 13, we have really a big point, you know, because during 09 to 13, it was only one of the association, art department, who was carry on, and he was always trying to tell us, we have to do something. But suddenly, in 13, something happened. There was a very big survey, and we saw that we are making 22% in each movie of the carbon print. And this gives us, you know, a shock. We say, my God, so we can do really something. If we can do only half of the steps that we have to do, it will be 11 less. And also, we see that location manager, all the logistical aspect, was 25. So we say, okay, we're going to take all these two departments, and we want really to work, and it will be already soon close to 50%. All right. And so in our department, we saw that it was not only the building to build, to construct, you know, or not only studios, but all the art department was really, really spent a lot of carbon, you know? And in the location manager, we saw that it was food. Food is a disaster, you know? So, by example, if you do just one day of vegetarian day in a shooting, you know, you save already some percent of your print, you know? So, just with one day with a vegetarian days, so it's not so easy for someone to understand that, but that we try to find, it's really what is the point, what we have to do, and where we have really to work and to do it better. So, by example, since a few months, we know that hotels, you know, when we are out of our place, it's a big disaster because hotels are, you know, they watch everything every day. So now, by example, with location manager, we are thinking how we going to you know, to be when we are outside of our place, you know. It's just all these details are very important. So the way is to know where really we have to push, you know. That was the very first thing. Okay. Non, c'est contraire. Okay, no, I was great. Okay, oh, all right. What that? Oh, so that we are so at once when because we start to go. We was in this time we go to all the fair, all the chat, and we see that they're always speaking about the shooting moment, never about before. And you know that before it's our moment, and our moment is maybe longer than the shooting, you know, days, a month, or weeks now. And so we say, why they don't speak about real thing, our department? Well, because we waste a lot of carbon. So we were focused in that. Okay, and we saw what skill, what tools they have already. They have the calculator for the carbon calculator. But what is a carbon calculator? Okay, you do the thing, and you know that you do it bad. It's interesting, because it gives you some data, little by little, years after years. You know that she's shooting, you do, 3,000 tons. This other, you know that you have to do 2,500 tons. Oh, less, it's normal. It was less construction, it was less build. So it gives you just, the level of your disaster, you know. So it's interesting to know it, because like that you can see, it's like that we have seen that hotels was a big problem, you know. Because the carbon clad is very boring to do, but why we don't try, by example, to help the administrators and the location manager to have some skills, some tools, new tools. Okay, that was the very first thing that we see. And so with Ecoprod, who is a high Paris Island commission film from the commission film, so we start recommendation, you know, it's something, but okay, it's a bottle in the sea, you know. But it's great because like that you think, we are a think tank, we are hating, and so we think about what we can do. So, give you some information, that was the first step. Okay, I can stay 1 hour and I can tell you the five steps, the five way to do it better, but more or less we know it. It's less something, and less and less and less. Less in a job that they ask you always more, something is wrong. So, in 15, something happened very interesting. We start not to be only the friends, you know, where the Isle of Paris Island and all these jobs that we have, beautiful movies, small movies, a lot of commercial TV and so on. We get, you know, an European association. So nowadays it's 13 countries. So it's great because it's not only our point of view, which is very French, with a lot of institution, with a lot of rule, a lot of flow. And so it's always very political. It's not only a question of what I can do, it's what it could be done by law, you know. So we have to work politically. We are an association, so we are heavy in some field, and little by little we grow up as a specialist in what it must to be done. And so in the heating person of the other department of the think tank Ecodeco, there was someone very practical. It was Sabine Barthélémy. She's a painter, scenic painter, and step by step she understands that by example, the water is a big problem. The water to watch, and now we go really in a concrete things, you know. Watch, by example, we saw that it's 1,000 town, 1,000 liter by movie. It's a middle, you know. Okay, if you do it very well after 20 years of work, because you know how to brush, to clean your brush, and maybe you're going to use 3,600 liters, 60 liters, if you have a small movie. But if you put the brush in the hand of your trainee, you are sure you go to the bathroom and it's 1,000 liters. So she makes step by step how we can do it less. We have also Valérie Valero. We are completely involved in how to reuse everything artistically. And she does with less, but more. Yes, it's work. All right. So, and like that, with all the other production designer and someone who is this way, by example, Stephanie, you know, she's very concrete, more step by step, and she tried to do it really from the beginning to the end, which is, I don't know how you do, you know, you're going to tell us. And it's another way. And so, little by little, you are tired, and sometimes, oh, a new one come, Chloe Kambunaki, and help us to be more in the communication, because we need people to communicate. For me, it takes me a long time to speak like I'm speaking today, you know? Because this is the point, information. Okay, you found the way to go to 1,000 liters, to 60 liters of water to clean brushes or rollers. So, but you have to communicate it. So that was a very important point. We need to talk all together. And when I see the collective I've done, I say it's incredible because we need really more things like that, more fair like that. Okay, so in 18, we was 18. Yeah, I never remember the first time. So, and we say we have to have a roadmap, a real one. And the first was a survey. So we start by ourselves, but we forget that we are not sociologic, we are not academic, and we are never paid enough with nothing in this field. You know, we do it for free, so it's a long time. And suddenly, we start alone, and Valerie and Chloe say, okay, we have to find a good person to do it, you know? And so we have to find money to pay it. And we start thinking about money, you know, money. Money gives the gourd. So, and we found the money. We found the money. It was the first time that we get money. And we pay the guy, and he do it so well. Because that we want is to know what our team, our department really want, and how they really want to do it, and what they know already. You know, because why we, it's not the, maybe the full field that we have to about the formation. Maybe it's just very technical or very logistical or the artistic point of view, because what's happened when you are in a movie? Yeah, it's very easy. You're going to say to the director, we don't do it like that. You know, if you are 40 years old in the job, maybe it's easy, but when you are only 5 or 10, it's not so easy. So it's all the diplomatic aspects. So this survey helps us to be close to the team and to understand what they really feel. Okay, the second step is a test lab. Test lab is important because we see in the suppliers' places a lot of different new products. So, you know, I try everything one by one. And so I see if it is possible, if it's dry well, if it's not... by example, we have a very big problem with the glossy and flat things. You know, if it is texture, you are always, you can take a piece of wood, plaster, and it's ecological. You know, you could have the feeling of it. And if you want to do a Chinese or Japanese shining, you know, it's very hard to find a natural or an ecological or a biological product, which is three different things. Biological, okay, it's grow up from earth, from the ground, okay. But you have to take care that it's maybe a solution. But if you do it too much, you are going to have a feel of like colza, you know, by example, 1,000 meter squares, and so it's a disaster also. And you have also the recycling one, who are interesting because it's garbage, it's dirty thing. It's all that we threw up on tanks, you know, and even if we... with the sword, and sword is interesting because it's a, you know, the identity of the garbage, of the dirty thing. And dirty thing in our job, we have many, many, and this is a richness. It's very good to have a lot of thing in our basket, in our tanks and so on, because we can take it, as you have done with the cartons from, and we can maybe do something with, you know? Maybe we can reuse it, but at the industrial level. So that we learn from test is that we must be close to, not suppliers, but those one, that the suppliers that means the factories. So we go to the factories and we ask them how is done, how the painter is done. Is the paint is done with a glue, is done with a color, and and is done with titan. Titan, what is titan? Titan is something horrible. We always think that acrylic is more ecological than the old paint, you know, with the spirit, white spirit. We say that in English, tiner, something like that. So, but I have to say something. When you use gas in the paint, it's very easy when it is you throw it into the water, you know, you see the it don't mix with water, this painting. So you think it's worse because it smells bad, it don't dry so well, and it's old-fashioned to work because now, since decades, we work with acrylic, you know. And it's true that in a different field, like, by example, resin, it's more interesting to be in acrylic because the cobalt was terrible, you know. I'm red because I've worked a lot with cobalt during 10 years, you know, in my workshop. So about health is not good. But suddenly, we understand because when the fabricator, when the factory said to us, the titan is a problem. Why? What is a titan? Titan can be separate from water. It's when it's mixed with the water, it's finished. So acrylic, when you threw acrylic into, you know, into the tube of your city, it's finished. This water can't be safe, because you know that we have at the end of the bottom of all that, this tube, there is a factory will take the water clean again. All right, but with titan it's impossible. So we have to do something with the idea, the way of Sabine Barthélemy, the scenic painter, that she does step by step, and how we can break the titan from the painting, because and why we need titan, you know? We need titan because it's more glossy, it's more bright, and it's more white. You know, like a dentifrice paste, a toothpaste, you know? There is also titan inside. All right, so each time when you throw up in the tiner, it goes to the, and you can't separate. So, you know, we was very worried. We say, we do a step, one, behind, and two, behind, you know? Okay, so we found the way, because we work with engineers, and we found a way to separate the titan. I'm going to tell you after. After it's the communication training, and so we start with something very easy. Okay, we have to speak about ecology, health, because there is a problem. If the product is not good for your health, it's not ecological. That's easy. Okay, after about safety, we have so many rules, so many laws in France, so you have to learn all of that. But in school, art school, they don't really learn about safety. But when you are an engineer of buildings, you know, yes, you have to. You have to know all the rules of the safety to do the job without any accident. But in our job, no. Why? Because in theater, in event, by example, there is the public. But when we make our job, we are all together, all the technicians, we are all together. And in this case, as we are professional, it seems that we know, I don't know how, you know, we know the rules of the safety work, you know. And it's not true, because if you come from architect, maybe a little, if you come from engineering, a little, but we come from art. And in art, they never speak about safety. And safety gives you maybe 10% of the ecological solution, and health gives you maybe 10 other. So it's already 20% less that you have to think if you know about health, in a work and safety. So it's very boring to learn it, but you know, it's an very important concrete skill that you need. All right. And after it's responsibility at work, that means it's more syndical, more union, you know. That means there is a producer and there is a workers. Okay. So what are their responsibility? What is the chain of subordination? Who is the guy who are going to say something, as you say, from the top to down, you know? That's the important thing.
William?
Yes.
Because it would be great if you, like, wrap it up in, like, 5 to 8 minutes, because I really would like the audience to give the questions. So could you maybe tell us a little more about the materials you were inventing? Because I think it's very, very interesting also for the audience. Okay. And then we will have some time for you to ask questions.
All right. Yes. So with the test, we found a lot of material, a lot of goods, a lot of new fabric, and so on. And so also the way is to save it in a place like you. We need to storage it because, you know, what is a studio for a real estate promoter, you know? It's an empty place where it can build something. And for us, it's an empty place where we can put element sets. So we try to find a way to do in each department the same kind of thinking. That's one thing. And little by little, as we go to close to the fabric, to the factories, we found effectively several products. This one is the very last one, and you know that we try, as we are close to our team, we try to see with what they work. And nowadays, you know, they work with this kind of fabric sheet, you know. It's from China. It's interesting because it's a recycling thing and it's not expensive. Normal way, it's more for isolation for buildings. And so we do plaster, we do a lot of things with that. And it's very interesting because it's not a glue to the frame, the wood frame, you know, to the panel. You can take off easily after and you save the wood because the thing is to work with layers, never glue. You know, they done cathedral and bolt before without any glue because the glue is a problem, the phenol in the glue is a problem. So we say, as we use that, why we don't try, because they know that, first thing to found a French one, because when we do a supplier, when it's down close to your place, it's less carbon. So we found the French fabric like that. So it was one step, less carbon because it's come from clothes, you know? Okay, so after we say, but that we need is stuff, something like wood. The problem is wood. So, this is the same thing, I'm Mary Poppins, but hard, you know? So we do it to two millimeters from 12 millimeters. Oh yes, you can, this one you know, huh? Okay, so imagine that the first thing that we have done to take from the hand, because it all is the hand at the beginning and the end. At the end, you have so many panels, and you want to save this panel, you know? And but there is a problem. This team do it 60 centimeters, millimeters. This one 44 millimeters thickness. So stop, please. We're going to do all the same. 78 millimeters. So we start with a very big builders, the builder departments, and we say, let's try to do it like that. Everyone, we have the same normative thickness of panels. And it's worked little by little. Now maybe 30 or 40% of our department in France don't like that. So we can save the panel because it's like a Lego, it's match. It's stupid, but it's match. So we have 100 and 100 panels that we can rent because if you want to do something, the first thing in a print foot, carbon foot, is to rent and not to buy. And if you buy, is to save it, to rent it after. This is a circular way to do it. So we try it, and okay, always I tell you, with textures, there is no problem. But when it's flat, it's a problem. So what we had is a layer of paper, you know, like we done in the old time when I started 42 years ago. So it worked very well. It's very flat. It's like a drum. And it's very strong because this one is 8 millimeters, this one is 3 or 4, I don't remember. And it's work, it's very flat, and after you can paint it and it can be bright, glossy, without any texture. So, because that was a problem. And the other problem is volumes. Volume is very hard to do. Okay, we use a new polystyrene, and it's very bad because it's only polystyrene with less polystyrene, but there is polystyrene. All right, so we know that plaster is interesting because we are here in the country of stucco, of stuff, and it's rope and plaster. It's an interesting thing, but for the health, it's not so good. So it's good for the planet, but not for you. All right, so you see this kind of stone that I have done in 20 minutes, it's big like that. With this panel that you have seen, but the 2 millimeters one, so you break a chair, so you have a chair break always in your workshop now, and you glue it, you put it in the in the wallpaper, you know, glue because it's rice, so it's ecological, you know, and you do the shape, a few stamples. And you dry, and you have this beautiful rock. And it's completely ecological, you know? So it's possible to make volume even with this product when it's less thick. So this is a miracle for the moment. We shall see, because we have to improve it in movies and movies to know if it is well at last. Because at the beginning, we was with a really natural product, you know, like flax, lean, I don't know the name, hemp, you know, chamber, you know, we can smoke it if you want, you can eat it. Yeah, the same, but without the. And so we do so many tries, so many samples, and it's very strong. And there is only the thing that you need to be a country like France, that there are, you know, the farmer, and there is many thousand meter squares in France of this kind of product. So for us, it's great. Maybe for another country, it's not great. So you have to find in your country what is the product natural fiber that you can use, and you make a fabric and do big fabrics and like that. This is for walls and also for floor. You can. This piece, I have it for now 4 years in my workshop, and we work on every day. Okay, so the other problem was plastic, you know, plastic. So how are we going to change our plastic? Because we like plastic, you know, it's fantastic. But with, when it's warm, it's better even because it takes a shape. So, but there is the PVC elimination is terrible and it's plastic. So we found something, but not really us. It's Dehant, it's a factory in the east of France, and with hemp, with glue, and they do a special textile, very slim, you know, and you can make some bricks and things like that. The only thing, you have to be step by step because it's 24 hours to be dry, you know, it's not. So the thing is, how we see in Ecodeco, the thing is to do it layers by step, don't glue it, and take the time to do it. So it's easy to say, take the time to do the things. Maybe you have 3 days to do things, but by example, you can make a cave really quickly with all that product, and it's less by less something that's happened economically is less expensive now. Not because it's cost a lot, because all the other product now cost a lot. So there was a balance, a natural balance after COVID, you know. As wood is expensive, steel is expensive, blah, blah, blah is expensive. This one, nobody buy it, nobody care of it. And it's still like that. There is no, how do you say, exploitation of that commercially, you know. It's a small little thing, you have in a fabric in the south of France, in the south of Czechia and so on. So they let us to do it because there is no real business. They don't see it because it's too technical. So we have to go fast and take these new products, well, not so new because it's a natural one, and really try it. I urge you to try all kind of new product, and like that, little by little, by yourself, you can say, oh, this is a good one, and this is not a good one. And nowadays, there is help about tax, and it's a very good moment to do all that, not revolution, because this will be political, but to do this technological way of thinking our thing. So there is so many things you can save. There is so many little things to do in schools, with builders, and think about stupid things like the legs to stand the panels. You can save 70% of wood with a stupid thing like this little thing that we done that take safety the panels. And so we did it also in wardrobe, in location manager, in documentation, in print things, and now Acme is something interesting also. It's about we have a lot of problem with brands, and we make a lot of fake brands. So now Acme is, that want to do Acme is to say, okay, you have done a fake brand, a fake Vuitton, a fake Dior, so please save it for the next movie, all right? Things like that. Okay, and the washing machine, you know the washing.
William, we have like 15 minutes left. So I would, do you still want to show that video of yours that's on the next page? Because as I would like to open the discussion for that is okay for you, because we have like...
It's okay for me, if it is okay for you.
I think it's a lot to take on, obviously. We have, there's a lot of input from all different approaches, like William's fantastic inventions and materials, I think if you're interested in that, you should definitely come and see him, because he can. He's very passionate about it, as you can see, and it's really amazing what he has achieved. So come and see him after this panel, for sure. And we have seen Tony, who have showed us how to do it in his country about recycling sets to the even like doing the glasses into beads, which I think is amazing. And we have seen Blair, who had a different approach on the Batman, as we've seen yesterday a little bit. But I really, really love that. And yeah, me myself, we did the catering and the sustainable Christmas trees out of backdrop. So again, I would like to invite you to ask questions and also maybe share your own experience, how you maybe recycled the set, how you used to do it, how and ideas. So yeah, we have like 15 minutes roundabout to ask questions, if there's any.
Hey, I'm working in Sweden, and yesterday there was a conversation started about using polystyrene to create like stone or a cave texture, a cave set. And a lot of people think, you know, oh, we don't have time to investigate. We just need to create the texture and carve and make a mess, kind of thing. But the construction companies in Sweden are really investigating this, and what they've done is gone out to one of our locations, one of our inspirations, and they took a silicon cast of a real castle wall and then created seven different designs in a metre by 2 metre sheets, and they put jute on the back and poured this eco-friendly plaster over the top. And it actually created a flexible sheet. And then you could create a timber structure for like walls or a cave, and you could bend this stone around it. So I would like to see that polystyrene is not used, and that we really consider the mess that we leave behind. And also with this plaster sheet, we're able to take it off the flats and take it to our next set and reuse it. So, yeah, investigate.
That's great.
Thank you.
Hi, thank you so much. That was just absolutely fantastic. And to see just the range of passion, and it's just applying our design minds to a different way of doing things. And in some ways, even going to back to when we were students and having no money and being resourceful with the things that are around us. And I'm from Australia, so we do things like have Facebook groups for local, in the local areas, so we share things. And if you're recycling a set, I myself personally, if I can take, I remember I made some big concrete columns, which were timber and plaster, but I used them on 4 shows and then passed them on to another show. So it's like, how can I recycle the sets that I have even? So I just think if we just apply the passion we have to our design work to the way we use materials, we can just be really inventive. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Cato. I'm from the Bay Area, which is the mecca of recycling and reuse. So I actually wanted to share with you a couple resources that I have. And some of you from LA might know Ecoset, which is an organization that actually accepts flats and larger set pieces to then either rent out or give away. And the way they function, like financially, is they charge for donations. So instead of a company paying for disposal, they're paying this company to give the materials, which then makes it easier for young people to come and use it for free. And if you're ever in the Bay Area making a movie, there's also Urban Ore, which has raw materials. So they'll accept sinks and bathtubs and windows. And so it's an architectural salvage facility. And I also, when I'm designing, when my projects are finished, I like to try to reach out to schools and give those materials and already built pieces to students to then see how it's constructed professionally. So I just wanted to share that.
Thank you so much. And I also would emphasize, like, everybody in here is a designer, and it's like we can design whatever we want, right? And it's like in the old days, like almost, I think we would design a rock, and then it will be made out of plastic or whatever, right? Or polystyrene or whatever, and really going back, as William also mentioned, to actually use plaster or whatever more sustainable. I mean, I know plaster is not the most sustainable, but it's a little bit better than styrofoam. But really not trying to create this mountain which is only made of plastic. That's in our hands, actually, and to take that to the productions, to especially for the younger generation, to say, well, we need the resources to actually build this, because we do not want to create a set and then have 5 tons of toxic waste nobody can ever use, and it will be in this world for 800 years.
Hi, I'm just wondering what your thoughts are behind potentially the future of the art department in terms of maybe we put in our terms and conditions for each job that art department gets a sustainability crew member to make sure that those processes happen throughout the entire film. Because we've just recently been on a television show where we were expected to sort of do all of those processes but have such a tight time frame, and then they didn't give us enough time in post-production to really recycle, and this was on a recycling show. Like, the topic was meant to be eco-friendly, so we did as much as we could, and we also asked to have a crew member, and we were declined. So I'm wondering maybe if, you know, collectively we ask for that crew member from the get-go.
That's a really good point. We're starting to do a little bit of that in England. We've got the Albert Initiative, which I've been working with for about 10 years. And a lot of the BBC and ITV shows have this kind of a green advisor who works within the production and kind of doesn't really so much police us, but documents and keeps the idea. We've had the green advisor kind of replaced by the COVID advisor in the last few years, which has kind of gone backwards a little bit. But yeah, that is the way forward. And a lot of the, like I said, the larger organizations, they have this guideline and they have this book, and they are actually keeping that happening. But it's as it's passed down to the smaller service companies, that's where it gets a little bit lost. But definitely, 100%, I'm with you. There should be some sort of sustainability advisor on every single job that at least keeps the communication of what we can do hand in hand. Because it's the departments not knowing what the other department is requiring or needing, and those agendas are at cross purposes. If one person could keep that fluidity, you're 100% right. That would make a big impact.
Hello. I want to... I agree with you. We have to share our experience, because it's so important to not waste so many wood and so many plastic and everything. And I just want to share an experience I had. I made a 700 square of set, and only with recycled panel wood from the ressourcerie that William showed, and we couldn't, he couldn't talk because he couldn't explain because you were, but it's only, I did all the set with all these recycled materials, and we used the machine of water. He couldn't explain, but for 700 meter square, we only use 30 liters of water, because this water, and I would like him to explain more, because this machine, we saw it in Brussels. They use it in the Brussels TV. And now we take it back to France to all the studios, and we talk a lot about this. And it's really amazing because with the same machine, the water is in a circle. Okay, maybe you can explain, William, because you explain better than me. Okay, thank you.
And William, you can also see that somewhere online, no? This machine, you have a website where you can see it, as I can remember, right?
Yeah, sorry. About how you're going to use no water, it looks incredible, but it's possible. It's really a machine completely, by himself. Even you don't need, it's by batteries. If you are in a land, you know, you can use it. So, and all that tool, this one is a specific one, there is several. And now that we have done also, because I hear you, is not only in our department, in our job, now we open this machine to the particular guy or woman who make his apartment, and you know, Andy have the brush, and he threw up, in the basket. So we say, no, we can take it, and we're going to clean it, and so it's a new thing. And a lot of things that we have done for us, by example, panels that we can't use, they are used now even in new buildings, because there was a big crisis, you know, about MDF, about all this wood. And so suddenly, real architects, you know, come and they take goods from our place, you know, from the Ossourcerie. The Ossourcerie, it's a storage place. So it's incredible. When you start something and when it's work, suddenly, it's not one field. It's you can do it with more amplitude, with more strength. You just need to try little by little, and there is so many ways to do it that every day we found new things. By example, with intelligence artificial, because we think always that it's a old-fashioned way to do the things. But I can tell you that now we are working with 3D print. And with artificial intelligence will give us something fast. Because we always speak about the numeric revolution, that's the past. Now it will be not an ecological revolution, it's a new technology. So there is something that it's a shame, you know. It's a shame because they always say, oh, we need, they give money for new technology with numeric, and no for a lot for ecology. It changed little by little. But in our field, we have also a lot of things to do with computers. Computers can help, yes, can help our way to do it better because it goes faster, but you have to know how to use it. And now the next step for our collective is what we're going to do with all that numeric tools to help us, you know, in the field of ecology. So we are not, you know, strength. We have this tool, and so we have to growing up with the tools that we know, and there is a lot of possibilities that's coming.
Thank you so much for that. So our time has run out.